Alors, bonjour tout le monde. Je crois que nous...
Hi everyone, I think we can start. First, I would like to highlight that it's my first meeting as the chair of the Board of Directors of the NCC, and it's with a lot of pleasure and enthusiasm that I accept and that I start this new mandate, and also with some humility, given the importance of this mandate that I would have to embark on for the next 4 years. Since NCC's story, history is important, we will celebrate 125 years next year, and it will be time for us to celebrate the past and to look forward to the future. So it will be a beautiful celebration. I also want to introduce new board members. We have six new board members: Scati Lewis, Kenneth Lewis, Sasha Palamarich, Samira Akram, et Adi Kikisis, et Eleanor Mohamed. Thank you for being here with us, and thank you for your commitment to NCC. And I also like to thank board members who are no longer with us. We have Lisa McDonald, Michael Furick, Larry Beasley, Deborah Morrison, Victor Brunet, and Sarah Jane O'Neill. Thank you for everything you have accomplished so far with other members of NCC. And it would not be fair to not highlight Mark Simmons' extraordinary work, my predecessor, who for 6 years made a huge difference within NCC, and his legacy would last a long time. So thank you once again. I would like to also welcome the citizens joining us here this morning, and also people watching us on our YouTube channel. So hi everyone. I would also like to highlight all the NCC team who are among us and who would give some presentations this morning. The mayor, Mr. Sutcliffe, and Madame Berin, unfortunately, are not able to join us today, but probably they will do so next time, because we are all working together with our municipal and provincial partners. Since it's when we work as a team that we are able to make a difference in the National Capital Region. So I would like to, before we officially start, I'd like to mention that we have a simultaneous interpretation, and for the presenters, please try to speak a bit slower so we can have a better translation. So enjoy the meeting, everyone. So I also like to highlight the work of our CEO, Toby. It's extraordinary. The collaboration has been fantastic for the last few weeks. So we would now open. So we would ask a vote for a resolution to suspend the paragraph 4.2.2, the administrative regulations of NCC, since the proposal about the building was not submitted on time. That is 3 days before. Do I have someone proposing? And Mr. Vaillancourt. Okay, as a seconder. Thank you. So we would now proceed with the adoption of the minutes. Tanya and Ken, okay. So we would now proceed with the adoption of the minutes from our last meetings. So it has to be someone who was present at the last meeting, Mr. Vaillancourt and Liz. Okay, thank you. I think that there is no business arising from the minutes, and any conflict of interest declaration statements? I don't think there are any. So now we are excited to listen to the report on activities. So now I'd like to invite Mr. Nussbaum. Welcome to this session. It's a pleasure for me to work with you.
I will take you through some activities that we've undertaken since our last meeting in April. Of course, May marked the 71st annual Canadian Tulip Festival, which drew hundreds of thousands of visitors to the National Capital Region. And I'd like to thank our dedicated group of landscape architects and groundskeepers and technicians for helping to bring about this most dazzling display of flora. And after 3 years of the pandemic, it was really nice to see all of the crowds there enjoying the wonderful bed. So it was truly a spectacular tulip festival this year. Spring also saw the return of our active use program, including our weekend bike days, which I'm very pleased to say are as popular as ever. Our teams were also busy advancing several rehabilitation projects, project guidelines, as well as sustainability and conservation efforts throughout the National Capital Region. La saison estivale s'annonce animée et j'ai hâte de vous donner les détails des activités.
So the summer season would be very busy, and I'm pleased to give you a summary of the planned activity.
La présidente, je suis heureux de vous annoncer.
So, Madam Chair, I am delighted to announce that on May 17th, we officially launched our asset integrity program at 24 Sussex Drive. This first step is important for the safety and preservation of this building, since we would remove the obsolete and dangerous electrical and mechanical systems, as well as designated substances present in the structure, such as asbestos. We are definitely taking care of securing the patrimonial elements, including material, as well as protecting them and storing them elsewhere to avoid them being damaged.
Phase three of the Victoria Island remediation project was tendered. It's expected the bulk of the work will be completed by the end of the year. Also in phase three of development is the Sir Georges Etienne Cartier Park Plan. The plan focuses on a 13-kilometer stretch of federal lands along the Ottawa River, and online consultations wrapped up this spring. Draft concepts and the proposed nodes for the site have been refined and will be presented to the Advisory Committee on Planning, Design, and Realty for comments in August. As for the cultural landscape study of the Rideau Canal Corridor, I'm happy to report that an MOU, a Memorandum of Understanding, has been signed between the NCC, the City of Ottawa, and Parks Canada. And the goal of the study is to identify key heritage values and character-defining elements along the canal, and to develop guidelines that will inform planning, project design, and the review of development proposals. The study will, of course, incorporate feedback from stakeholders and the public, and we expect to launch it very soon. In a similar vein, the Rideau to Rideau Master Concept Plan is being developed to bridge the gap between large-scale policy directions as to what's being considered within the review of the 2005 Core Area Sector Plan and the detailed and technical site considerations for Lady Grey Drive reinstatement. And the proposed planning approach went before the ACPDR last month, and we're very excited to continue and advance on that project. Une bonne nouvelle pour le pont Champlain.
So, a good news for the Champlain Bridge. The second stage of the restoration has now been completed. We have also removed all the asphalt, repaired concrete, removed the membrane, and also re-put asphalt. And we have concluded the center lane. So, the setup is in place for the third and final phase. And the work is progressing very well, and we are hoping to conclude by November. That is 8 months early.
Public Services and Procurement Canada recently awarded a contract to Arup Canada Incorporated to support the Alexander Bridge replacement project. This technical advisor will work with PSPC and the NCC as part of an integrated project team to coordinate and complete several economic, heritage, and environmental studies, as well as develop the conceptual designs of the new bridge. We are also working to update the data in our long-term integrated interprovincial crossings plan. New traffic studies and surveys will soon be initiated on the movement of people and the movement of commercial vehicles in the region. And last month, the NCC issued a contract for truck data collection. As data on interprovincial truck travel patterns is very outdated, so on-site data collection is expected to happen later this summer to collect information on where trucks are going when they cross the McDonnell-Cartier Bridge. And this new data will complement the Household Origin Destination Survey, which will also be included in the revised crossings plan. La navette du parc de la Gatineau est de nouveau.
So the Gatineau Park shuttle, it's now operational for summer. We can take the shuttle at 3 stops in downtown Gatineau and Ottawa, and at 8 stops in the Gatineau Park. This year, we have added 10 days to the length of the program. That will be 30 days in total. The shuttle would be every 30 minutes on Saturdays and on Sundays from May 20th to August 27th. All stops are accessible, and all buses have a low floor and are equipped with an access ramp. As last year, students will be informing people on the natural resources and cultural resources of the park at several stops.
That Trans-Colline, in partnership with the NCC, has extended its service to line 924 to offer weekend transportation from the Galerie d'Ol to Breton Beach at Lac Philippe. And bus service is free of charge for users on weekends right up to October 22nd. And it includes, importantly, 2 connections with our Gatineau Park shuttle, located at the Gatineau Park Visitor Center and at Montcalm. L'enlèvement.
The removal of hazardous material and the demolition is continuing, is ongoing at Lake Philippe, and the preparation for the foundations are currently underway, and also there are archaeological digs in the sector. Ian Bagley and Monica, our archaeologists, currently have found stone tools nearby, and these quartz artifacts that date back to 3,000 to 6,000 years are also a reminder of the long history of the Algonquin Anishinaabe First Nations in the region.
Lac Philippe to Westboro Beach, work is progressing well on the site. The foundation work is now complete, and the steel structure is expected to be erected this summer. A community meeting was held on May the 3rd to provide an update on the project, and similar engagement is planned throughout the project. Our teams have improved signage and taken other steps to make sure the current detour is easier and safer to use. And we are very pleased, of course, to learn that Michael Anlauer is poised to be the new owner of the Ottawa Senators, and we look very much forward to working with the team in the context of our existing memorandum of understanding for a major event center at the Breton Flats. À propos le Breton, la
session. So at this, the NCC is working. Since an innovative conception, it's on the way that will create more calm streets and structures and more green as well. This new planning step would ensure organized continuity for the next steps. The improvements of the public domain near PMC station would also be monitored this summer, because public art and the spaces, seating areas would be improved, and people would also be able to benefit from this spot, and also this area would be accessible to the old train.
Since our last board meeting, we've hosted 3 successful urbanism labs. The first, on Canada Central Parks in the 21st century, held in April, featured retrospective and future-oriented perspectives on Canadian urban green spaces. In May, the 2023 Urban Design Challenge received some truly incredible ideas from students right across the country to reimagine the core area in the capital. And last month, we also held the Lessons in Indigenous Planning Lab, which featured a very thought-provoking panel of Indigenous speakers who underscored the vital role Indigenous land use planning plays in preserving cultural heritage, protecting ecosystems, and promoting sustainable development. And in keeping with our commitment to Indigenous engagement, I'm happy to report that we've been updating the 2017 protocol for the co-management of archaeological resources between the NCC, the Kitigan-Zibi Anishinaabeg, and the Algonquin Sipikwakanagan First Nation. And these agreements ensure direct input from the communities, particularly as it relates to archaeological matters on federal lands in the region. And the new clauses to be added concern truth and reconciliation calls to action, the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, the disposition of artifact collections, and capacity building. Pour 2023, nous avons...
So for 2023, we intend to combine our activities with public archaeological digs that are ongoing, that take place every year in August on the site of the Lac Le May Park. And if you didn't have the opportunity to do so.
As we continue to strengthen our commitment to diversity and inclusion, I'm pleased to report that the 2SLGBTQI+ National Monument 100% developed design will be presented to the Board of Directors today for federal land use and design approval. And I'm delighted to share that our Capital Culture Lives Here partnership with the Saw Gallery for their Artist in Residence program is thriving. The Rochon residence has received excellent reviews from artists who have stayed there, including Lido Pimienta, the Polaris Prize-winning musician and visual artist who took up residence from May 15th to June 11th. So with that, I'll turn to our fourth and final organizational priority.
Comme je l'ai souligné, as I mentioned during the last board meetings, NCC has resolved to ensure low carbon neutrality and climate resilience by 2050. And to start with, the NCC has prepared a carbon neutrality plan for its real estate portfolio in order to determine the measures and the costs related to the carbon reduction year, the greenhouse on its building. Et vous allez voir ici, nous allons vous présenter les résultats de la stratégie de développement durable de 2018 à 2023. Nous allons annoncer ici que nous avons complété ou bien nous allons faire avancer 35 des 36 actions mentionnées. Et à ce moment-ci, la mise en œuvre de la stratégie n'est pas juste un effort collectif à travers l'organisation, mais une collaboration entre plusieurs partenaires de la région, de la capitale nationale.
Future strategy, the 2023 to 2027 Sustainable Development Strategy, which will be tabled in Parliament by November 2nd. And this strategy really does build upon the lessons learned from our first two Sustainable Development Strategies, and it will set an ambitious course for a more sustainable and climate resilient NCC and National Capital Region. Nous affirmons également notre engagement.
So we are also reaffirming our commitment to the conservation and to biodiversity. After an agreement with Environment and Climate Change Quebec, the team at PARC, at the Gatineau Park, has joined the network on biodiversity in Quebec that evaluated the capacity of the natural species to deal with climate change.
The Quebec Urban Lands and Gatineau Park teams will soon conclude two new contribution agreements. This program provides financial assistance to encourage scientific research on NCC lands. The two projects selected for this year include a two-year study on the response of birds and mammals to vehicle traffic in the park, and a study on the impacts of predatory fish introductions and their impact on native species and mussels in Gatineau Park lakes and streams.
Enfin, Madame la Présidente, j'aimerais souligner que le toit.
So, to conclude, Madam Chair, I'd like to mention that June 3rd has been identified as the National Biking Day. For this occasion, we participated in an activity organized by the European Diplomatic Community, the City of Ottawa, Bike Ottawa, and Enviro Center on the Queen Elizabeth Drive.
Making active transportation as enjoyable and accessible as possible by creating fun, safe spaces for all ages and abilities. And a few years ago, we expanded on the success of our weekend bike day programs by reserving a portion of the Queen Elizabeth Driveway for all active modes of transport. And this has proven very, very popular with the public. This year, we're seeing numbers in excess of 6,000 visits on the street alone on the weekends, not counting the neighboring pathways. So it's been a very successful project this year. So, in conclusion, after a long presentation, but hopefully informative, we're hoping everyone, residents and visitors alike, will explore the countless events and activities and great natural and urban spaces our beautiful National Capital Region has to offer, from our beaches to our bistros. We think there's something for everyone. So again, an encouragement for everyone to enjoy this beautiful but sometimes short summer season. Alors, c'est tout. Merci beaucoup, Madame.
So that's it. Thank you so much, Madame Chair. Thank you for this. Highlighting all the different projects and the initiatives. We are very lucky to live in the beautiful National Capital Region for those who live in this region. Obviously, are there any questions or comments? So thank you very much for this report. So now we would invite our ombudsman, Madame Oriana Trombetti, to present her yearly report for 2022-2023. Thank you for being here. We are all ears.
Madam Chair, members of the board, it's a pleasure to be here among you all, and congratulations to those of you who have been recently appointed. I know that you've received a copy of my report in advance. I hope that you've had an opportunity to take a look at it. I'm now in the third year of my mandate. This particular report covers the period April 1st, 2022 to March 31st, 2023. Key to the functioning of this office is the possibility that the public has access to my services. Contact is made through the website or through a telephone call to me. During the period under review, there were 51 contacts with the office. This is generally in keeping with the previous review period. The public contacts me about all sorts of issues. I'll give you a few examples. Access to public parks, closures of parkways, construction issues, establishment of dog parks, condition of private property that's located close to NCC property. The list goes on. Most matters I refer to officials at the NCC, and they provide a response, and the matter is taken care of. Sometimes, though, the issue I'm contacted about is outside of my mandate. I've noticed recently that I'm getting more inquiries about federal government programs and provincial government programs. In these cases, I'm still trying to help citizens either redirect them or give them the information that they need. There are two files in particular that I would like to comment on this morning. The first is a file that I've been dealing with since I was appointed, and that is the issue of access to the Gatineau Park parkways by motorized vehicles. This continues to be commented upon by members of the public, and in this last review period, again, I received inquiries about the schedule and decisions that were made at the National Capital Commission. For those of you who are not aware, I did previously carry out an investigation and I submitted my report to the National Capital Commission in November of 2021. Since then, one member of the public has filed a complaint with the Canadian Human Rights Commission. I've been following that issue to see what the Canadian Human Rights Commission's decision would be on that, and they have decided to accept it for a review panel, and I'm waiting for that hearing to take place. So that should be sometime in the next 6 months, 6 to 8 months. I will continue to follow that issue. The second file that I wish to comment on is the open water swimming pilot project at Meech Lake. Over the last couple of years, I have received comments and pictures and emails about what's going on in particular at Meech Lake. Last summer, I had several meetings with National Capital Commission officials. They were very gracious in explaining to me their approach to the issues that are taking place at Meech Lake. Following those meetings, I had a conversation with Mr. Nussbaum, and I made some recommendations. The information that I have suggests that the officials took the recommendations into consideration and that the situation is improving. I think they're building upon lessons learned at Meech Lake and trying to adjust the program. It's a relatively new program. I continue to follow this issue as well. In closing, I would like to note that all my dealings with National Capital Commission staff have been very good. Information's been provided, meetings have been scheduled, follow-up takes place very diligently, and so I'm very encouraged by that. Those are my comments for today. I look forward to continuing my mandate into the next year and coming back to brief you on activities next year again. Happy to take any questions that you have.
Thank you very much for your report. Any questions or comments? No?
Thank you.
So thank you, and see you next year.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Alors, nous avons...
So now we would proceed to the NCC Sustainable Development Strategy Annual Report. And I'd like to invite Mr. Migueles and his team for the presentation. Hi, Madam Chair, and thank you very much. We are delighted to share the fifth annual report for the Sustainable Development Strategy of 2022-2023 to share the accomplishment, environmental sustainability, and climate resilience. It's among the priorities. And in fact, we are displaying leadership for the last 20 years, and we have been reporting on the progress for more than 10 years. And the current Sustainable Development Strategy that was launched in 2018, it's an initiative that will guide our activities. And the collective efforts in the organization, once again, show us the progress that we have done. So I would like to introduce Genevieve Mercier, who would proceed with the presentation this morning. Thank you.
Hello.
Thank you, Alain.
Thank you. On behalf of all of my colleagues, the Sustainable Development Strategy Annual Report 2022-2023. I want to highlight that the report, as well as the achievements presented in it, are the result of a corporate-wide engagement and effort toward building a more sustainable national capital region. I'll continue in French.
Je vais Before presenting the highlights of this annual report, I will first of all like to proceed with a summary of this strategy. It focuses on two main priorities, partnerships for a sustainable region and the improvement of the environment to promote human health. In addition to these two priorities, there are 6 principles, 10 objectives, 36 actions, and 76 indicators. Our sustainable development strategy contributes to 10 of the 17 sustainable development goals of the United Nations and the objectives of the Federal Sustainable Development Strategy for 2022-2023. It includes actions aiming to reduce our impact for climate change, and we have learned to adapt. It includes actions related to health and human well-being, forests, lakes, and it also includes measures with regarding sustainable and also the involvement of Canadians with nature. Once again, last year, there were several accomplishments. I would briefly talk about 6 realizations, accomplishments. Since 2006, the NCC has reduced its greenhouse gas emission compared to 2005. And this very important reduction, it's due in part to the electrical use in Ontario. And we see here that we have initiated the development of the zero emission plan for our real property portfolio plan. And this initiative, it's included in our climate change initiative with a group of actions aiming to reduce greenhouse emissions, as well as estimate cost estimates and priority projects. The NCC has also initiated the elaboration of an action plan. And this action plan would address priorities and also the evaluation of risk to climate change for NCC. Actions would also be identified to improve processes in all our activity sectors to improve resilience. The NCC also completed several plans and several important policies that will help the NCC reach its objectives with regards to sustainable development. First, the adoption of a new green procurement policy, and also with the Secretary. And as for next step, the NCC will update its new capital design guidelines in order to ensure that we follow the guidelines, and the work will be done in the context of the next sustainable development strategy for the next cycle, 2023 to 2025. And we also finalized the new capital design guidelines, and also this establishes excellent standards in the national capital region and guarantees the integration of key elements, including the accessible universal accessibility, comparative analysis, gender-based analysis.
Conservation in perpetuity of the two properties located in the Laramac Ecological Corridor and Breckenridge in the Gatineau Park, as well as 18 hectares in the Breckenridge. A program was put in place to protect these corridors and enable their protection with partner organizations. The NCC contributes financially to the protection of these high ecological value sites. As of the 31st of December 2023, 35 of the 36 measures, 72 of 76 of the actual targets, these have been reached, or 46 of these are on the point of being reached. Work has begun, but challenges were met and timelines were pushed back for these indicators. Four indicators will not be reached before the end of the current strategy. The first of these four pertains to waste disposal on NCC properties. With regards to these events organized on NCC property, new measures will be put in place. These efforts will be moved also to the Confederation Boulevard corridor from the Rideau Canal corridor. For these four targets that will not be achieved, this requires a new strategy for urban lands. We will focus on agricultural lands instead. We are proud to having achieved a 97% of our strategy. On top of these high points, we've adopted a safe guideline for birds. We've started a strategy on the forest and canopy to protect urban trees. We have acquired climate projects to mitigate climate change effects. We have converted our fleet towards electric vehicles. We have continued our efforts for the diversion of waste and also waste from the Rideau Canal activities. We have improved the climate projections and acquired risk assessment for plans. We have achieved 20 projects with this in mind, and we've worked with over 400 volunteers in this activity of we will be presenting the draft for the 23-27 cycle, as this new strategy will be filed by the minister before permanent in the fall. There will be a transition period between our current strategy and the new cycle one. The next report we will present you in June 2024 will include a summary of the current strategy and will also provide a peek at the new strategy objectives. This concludes my presentation. We hope that you have appreciated the report that was provided to you. I'm happy to answer your questions. Miigwech, thank you. Thank you, Madame Mercier, for this presentation. Any comments or questions? Denis, thank you, Chair. In 2018, I was there for the first presentation by Genevieve. It was full of energy, and I see that enthusiasm is still there. This is a success story. The strategy was well-crafted and well-implemented. In conversations informally held yesterday, I learned that the staff of NCC, that the bike locker is full.
Pour cette mise en œuvre et on a hâte de voir les prochaines étapes. Merci.
So we're happy to see that the staff walks the talk. I will move. Yes, Sasha and then Ken.
Tu veux approuver, Sasha, et non pas intervenir.
So, Sasha, you wish to propose and not intervene. You have something to say, Ken? Yes, Madam Chair. With regards to the new purchase policy, with regards to purchasing and procurement, have we implemented any measures to encourage our partners and our contractors, our suppliers, to adopt those strategies? Thank you for your question. Yes, for example, we've already prevented the use of two-stroke motors, for example, for landscaping and maintenance. We are preferring battery-powered equipment now. And most recently, during the last forum with our partners, we are trying to understand better their emissions so that we can assist them with improving the targets and in the context of their work. I think the work has already been started on that, so I don't know if you have a further question or...
Last year, to become the first jurisdiction in Canada to ban gas-powered small tools, and you have asked us in priority four to demonstrate national leadership, and that was an example of doing exactly that. And we worked very closely with the maintenance contractors. We gave them sufficient time for a transition. Norm was asking me the other day about, are they doing okay with batteries? Because yes, they have to buy additional batteries to make sure the tools work. But that really is just the start of thinking through, you know, how we can make sure the maintenance contractors are also following along with our intentions. And one of the ways we've also done that is in our last central maintenance contract, we asked people bidding on the contract to consider how smaller vehicles and electric-powered vehicles could also be used next to and along the pathways so that we don't have large pickup trucks blocking the pathways and that we move towards a more sustainable vehicle fleet for our maintenance contractors too. So just to say that there's a number of really important initiatives in terms of ensuring that we're not just talking about the NCC and the NCC's corporate objectives, but spreading that to our various contractors and partners.
Oui, alors Denis.
Je fais mon commentaire, j'ai une question. Et pour les collègues, les anciens collègues.
I have a follow-up, and so this is a question in the spirit of Victor, our former board member. You talked about new plantations of trees, the planting of new trees. So how many have we planted, and how does this fit in with the national strategy? Over the last years, we have planted roughly 20,000 new trees. So the teams, architecture, landscaping, and forestry technicians have continued to work hand in hand, especially in light of the recent events like the derecho. They've been called on probably more so to counter those events and the deal. And so we're working more and more with Resource Canada to upgrade our tree planting strategy so to fall in line with their efforts. So we continue to work together, and I'm confident that in the coming years more and more trees will be planted, and in fact more and more trees will be protected.
Congratulations, really great work. Just wanted to ask a question regarding the indicators in general. First of all, there's a lot of indicators, like 70 plus indicators. So just a general question around is there any issue with respect to the amount of resources you have to deliver against those indicators? Whether it's dollars or HR resources, and is it impacting on how you prioritize the work with respect to achieving all of the indicators? I guess even more generally speaking, are we being overambitious with our indicators because we have so many of them? Are you able to really focus in on what, you know, what the priority should be in that regard?
Thank you for your question. We've been learning a lot with working with, you know, realistic key indicators, KPIs, key performance indicators, 76, yes, it's a lot, I have to say. But integrating sustainable development throughout our business line have been key, and it's also part of our DNA at the NCC. You know, environmental sustainability is something that we've been doing for years, so it's part of our mandate. It's, you know, the reason. So you'll see that as we're moving with the next sustainable development strategy, there's less indicators, and there are really more smart indicators also that are going to be easier to track, monitor. In terms of the capacity for this current strategy, 18-2023, we had a budget of about $3.4 million that was allocated in terms of goods and services, capital investment, and human resources. That $3.4 million has been completely spent or will be spent by the end of this cycle. So we are going to be reassessing and continue to actually optimize processes and integrate business, like sustainability through business lines. So I hope I'm answering your question. So we've learned a lot working with so much KPIs. We've been improving how we monitor progress, how we're building capacity internally. And I look forward for my colleague Kim to present you the draft sustainable development strategy just after this. And you'll probably see a bit of a shift in terms of the type of indicators that are included.
Yeah, that's great. Just to focus in more on what we think is most important.
Yes.
But don't get me wrong. I think what we want to do is encourage you to deliver on those indicators and have all the resources you need to do so, because it's such an important initiative. So thank you.
Thank you.
Oui, Andy.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Yes, Andy.
Point-based system or any type of system built into maybe the procurement model that helps encourage vendors towards more sustainable or innovative methods or systems of sustainability. Just maybe part of the evaluation matrix or some incentivized system, especially with the market conditions now, vendors are really have the luxury of choosing which procurements they bid on. Are we sort of trying to incentivize them or giving them the opportunity to come forward with some point-based system?
Perhaps I don't have specifics to provide, but I have seen this integrated within some of the procurement processes to encourage it. Is there a system in place? There's a process in place that certainly encourages the industry to actually include sustainability within their offers. It's certainly something that is viewed and is actually encouraged.
Thanks, Manny. Yeah, just to add and to offer some specific examples, Andy, in our major maintenance contracts, which are really large, they're important, and they're essentially the contracts where we put out procurement for different landscape companies to look after our flower beds and look after pathways and essentially steward most of our lands. And they're broken up into five different contracts. And as I mentioned with the small tools, we started with that, but increasingly we are incorporating a point system. So in the last major maintenance contracts for the central area, for the core area, we did a point system on that electric vehicle point that I mentioned earlier. And that is just really the beginning of doing exactly what you said, not necessarily insisting on it, but incentivizing and actually inviting contractors to come up with their own ideas about how they can green operations. So it is something that we're doing increasingly. We started with the major maintenance contracts. I think there's going to be opportunities for that. Tanya, in her presentation yesterday on procurement, talked about developing a green procurement policy writ large. So we recognize that there is a lot of opportunity for this. I think in the construction area too, there's more and more attention being paid to the carbon impact of different materials, and we're of course moving to a zero carbon building standard, but there's another issue of, in the construction of these buildings, are we being conscious of what the climate impact is of that as well? So it's a really important area. We've got more work to do, but I think my point is we started and we recognize that there's an opportunity to help achieve many of our objectives in that area.
Any more comments or questions? Non, alors,
Seeing none, I think that it was moved. The recommendation was moved and supported. Are there any objections? Seeing none, congratulations. The report is adopted as presented. Thank you. We will now continue with the same team with regards to the strategy for the new cycle. Mr. McGillis, thank you, Madam Chair. We will immediately move on to the final draft of the strategy for sustainable development for the next cycle, 23-27. The strategy we are presenting to you is based on the lessons learned and the successes from the prior cycle, 2009-2017, and what you just saw, the 22-23.
First, the strategy responds to federal sustainability priorities by outlining what the NCC will do to contribute to the goals and targets of the federal sustainable development strategy that you'll hear referred to as the FSDS. Secondly, this strategy acts as an important mechanism to implement and report on the NCC's progress towards its corporate priority to demonstrate leadership in achieving an environmentally sustainable and climate resilient national capital region. And third, the strategy will help the NCC foster an internal culture of sustainability by changing the way we do business. And I think some of the questions around the table about the annual report highlighted how much, even though we have a strategy that is prepared by our group, the implementation of the strategy really resides in every single branch of the NCC.
Alors, cette stratégie est une stratégie. This is an ambitious strategy that will help the NCC become carbon neutral and more resilient, partnering with and improving our relations with First Nations and improving the health and well-being of all Canadians.
Pass it over to Kim Monahan, Manager of Sustainable Development Programs, for the presentation. Thank you.
Thanks, Alain. Hello, bonjour, Kwe. In 2018, the NCC adopted its current Sustainable Development Strategy 2018 to 2023. This strategy was aligned with federal sustainability targets, and its implementation has helped the NCC showcase its progress towards more sustainable operations and a more sustainable national capital region. In 2019, the NCC made it a corporate priority to demonstrate national leadership in achieving an environmentally sustainable and climate resilient national capital region. In 2020, the NCC voluntarily became one of two Crown corporations to sign on to the Federal Sustainable Development Act. This act requires the Government of Canada to table in Parliament every 3 years a federal sustainable development strategy that defines Canada's sustainability priorities and actions. The 2022 to 2026 iteration of the strategy is based around the 17 United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which you see here. Nearly 100 federal organizations are subject to the Federal Sustainable Development Act, and each one must contribute to the federal strategy through the development and implementation of their own sustainable development strategy and must report to Parliament annually on their progress. In 2021, the NCC's Board of Directors gave a clear direction to staff that the NCC should go beyond simply aiming to achieve the federal targets and work towards creating an internal culture of sustainability by integrating sustainable development into all our business lines. To this end, the NCC has developed a new sustainable development strategy for the period from 2023 to 2027. Which responds to our federal obligations while also highlighting the NCC's unique role in building a more sustainable national capital region and outlining our commitment to building a culture of sustainability at the NCC. The process followed to develop the new strategy included two rounds of extensive internal consultations. The NCC also participated with other federal organizations in the consultation process to develop the 2022 to 2026 Federal Sustainable Development Strategy. The strategy being presented to you today was reviewed by Environment and Climate Change Canada, who administer the federal strategy, to ensure we're aligned with their requirements for performance measurement. In the spring, the NCC also engaged with regional stakeholders to present our sustainability priorities for 2023 to 2027 and discuss collaboration and regional alignment of priorities and targets. We also updated the public on these priorities through the NCC's website. We are seeking approval from the Board of Directors on the final draft of the Sustainable Development Strategy 2023 to 2027 before sending it to Public Services and Procurement Canada to table in Parliament by November 2023. Under its new strategy, the NCC's key environmental priorities for the next 4 years will focus on mitigating and adapting to climate change, providing sustainable access to NCC green spaces, reducing waste and greening our purchasing and operations, advancing reconciliation with Indigenous peoples, protecting natural capital, and integrating sustainable development into NCC policies, planning, decision-making, and operations. As mentioned, the 2022 to 2026 Federal Sustainable Development Strategy is based on the 17 United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. Under the federal strategy, the NCC is identified as being a contributor to goals 10 through 13. To work toward these goals, the NCC has developed actions to advance Indigenous reconciliation through its projects, improve sustainable and active transportation in the region, improve sustainable access to our green spaces, develop and implement guidelines for green procurement, and increase waste diversion, improve the climate resilience of our assets, programs, and operations, and to achieve net zero carbon emissions for our fleet, real property, and procurement by 2050. We've also included additional voluntary actions in our strategy to show leadership and highlight the NCC's contributions to sustainable development under Goal 11 in the area of affordable housing, and Goal 13 in the area of greening government operations. These operational actions focus on greening our land maintenance operations, reducing bird collisions with our buildings, planting trees and maintaining the tree canopy, and preserving the ecosystem services provided by our green spaces. Additional actions were also developed under Goal 2 to highlight the NCC's sustainability efforts on its agricultural lands, and Goal 15 to underline the NCC's work on protecting ecological corridors and addressing invasive species. It should be noted that not everything the NCC does that contributes to environmental sustainability is included in the Sustainable Development Strategy. Rather, the strategy aims to show progress towards sustainability that is beyond our business as usual. Additional actions are either actions that are being carried forward from our last strategy, where we will take the next step, or new sustainability initiatives that are important to highlight or report on, or that we want to mainstream to make them business as usual. Our new obligations will present a significant challenge for the NCC, and if we are to succeed, it will require some changes to the way we operate. Although the NCC has been integrating sustainability into its work for several years now, as per the board's direction, we must now put in place a more formalized process to manage the integration of sustainable development into our business lines. With this in mind, we developed a management framework and specific commitments to incorporate sustainability into all aspects of our work and build a culture of sustainability at the NCC. These commitments are based around the themes of fostering good governance and accountability, integrating sustainability into business practices, including planning, decision-making, and operations, optimizing resources and capacity, and leading and collaborating. These commitments will help ensure that the NCC is successful in implementing its sustainable development strategy and will also provide an opportunity to streamline processes and ensure alignment of NCC priorities. Once the sustainable development strategy has been approved, we will proceed with sending the document to our minister to table the strategy in Parliament as required under the Act. At the same time, we will begin working towards integrating sustainable development into our business lines. This will include updating the NCC's environmental policy and developing guidelines to further define how some of the actions in the strategy will be implemented. Another priority will be to continue to review NCC planning, decision-making, and operational processes to determine how better to integrate sustainable development. The sustainable development team has begun working with some groups who've already initiated a process review. On this slide, you'll see the recommendations that we are making to the board today. In closing, I would just like to reiterate that this new strategy will not only help the NCC develop a roadmap toward carbon neutral, climate resilient assets, programs, and operations. It will also help the NCC foster an internal culture of sustainability, and it will be an important mechanism to measure and communicate to the public the NCC's progress towards achieving a more sustainable and climate resilient national capital region for all Canadians. We thank you for your time today and look forward to hearing your comments and answering your questions on the strategy. Thank you. Merci. Miigwech.
Merci, Madame Monahan.
Thank you, Mrs. Monahan. Are there any questions, comments? Yes, Tanya.
Thanks for the presentation. I just wanted to acknowledge, I think that this latest strategy really demonstrates the maturity and of both the capacity and the commitments that the NCC is really developing in this space. And in particular, one of the things that I really like about this strategy is the transparency and the recognition of the, for each of the actions, the starting point of where we're at. And I think that that kind of transparency is incredibly helpful and important to indicate, you know, the journey that we're on and the commitment that we're taking. And it's a helpful reminder of, you know, where we're starting from, quite literally, but also, you know, I think it helps to match what the ambitions can be. And so I think that that's a great approach that you've taken to, you know, sort of highlight again this commitment, and that, you know, not everything can happen overnight, but that it really is a journey. So I appreciate the transparency for sure in that process. And with that, I'd be happy to move the recommendation.
Alors, c'est pour appuyer. Ah, Cathy, pour appuyer.
May I comment?
Of course.
Oh, I'd like to.
Just wanted to note, just a comment, how compelling the key priorities are, how clear the context and background was. Sharing the development process, very helpful. Like how we've got to hear what's happening next, really thankful. And this is an example of what a strategy is. Like, this is actually a strategic document and plan and process. So congratulations.
Denis?
Je vais appuyer la proposition.
Denis, yes, I will second the motion. This will take up the my previous comment. So 13, we talk about, we know that with the derecho, 70% of our lands are have tree cover. Is there any cleanup planned for all those trees that have been downed? Because the, you know, this is the main canopy of, so we're planting new trees because your picture is revealing. So are there strategies for those trees that have been felled by the derecho? I will answer this to the best of my knowledge. I will call maybe under Anne and her team. Yes, there have been considerable efforts made to secure pathways and deal with trees fallen by the derecho. Under Simon's team as well, for the forestry team to continue the improving and the protection of urban tree canopy. I think that maybe Anne or Simon can weigh in on that important question. Thank you, Genevieve. I would add that it's not something that can be done quickly. Unfortunately, it'll take a couple of years. So we focused our efforts where people are found and are frequently going to, because you know there are dangerous situations. We will continue, there are contracts, but these efforts will take time.
First off, I just want to say, having been involved with the Sustainable Development Goals on the international scene for a number of years now, I can say that this is one of the most impressive documents I have seen. So kudos to the team for putting this together. I do have one comment, kind of question. It's on page 14, and it's in relation to action 11.6 when it comes down to affordable housing. The first part of my question is, how many housing units are projected for the Building Le Breton project? Do you have that yet?
Yeah. Madam Chair, I understand the number is around 5,000.
Okay. So thank you for that. So part two is more of a comment. I'm wondering if we could be a little bit more bold in terms of your target for affordable housing. Currently, it's at 200. Is there potentially for looking to achieve a percentage or perhaps a higher number, just given the housing crisis that we're in? And given that the NCC is the leader of planning in the National Capital Region, I think this would be a really great way to model how forward-thinking we are in addressing the housing crisis. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My understanding is that the number of 200 applies to one of the sites, but I'll have my colleague Bill Leonard perhaps speak a little more about this. We are, however, working with our colleagues in real estate to identify opportunities for additional housing to be built near transit and near rapid transit. And I think that's an important point, is that housing affordability has many dimensions. There is the cost of the housing itself, but then there is the cost of living somewhere. And if people have the opportunity to have options with respect to mobility that don't involve car ownership, it's a huge savings on a family budget. Mm-hmm. And anything we can do to open those opportunities and provide those options are things that we do want to do and embed in the planning lens.
Sure, thank you. No, the goal for Le Breton is actually quite higher. In the master concept plan, I think it's 25% of all the units there should be affordable. However, the 200 that's within this report, that's specifically to the Dream Le Breton phase, and I think it's 43%, 41 or 43% of all the units in the Dream Le Breton phase are actually for affordable housing. Now, the one thing that we had to be careful about in the sustainability policy is that affordable housing is not the NCC's mandate, it's with CMHC. So we really depend on them for that particular aspect of it. So there is interdependency, so we can't necessarily control that. We have that target, but we do plan on working with them for them to help us make that happen.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much for the precision. Any comments, questions? If there are no comments or questions, then this recommendation has been moved by Tania and seconded by Denis. Any objections? No objections. Okay, congratulations once again. Thank you. So it will be tabled at Parliament. So this is a good news for all Canadians. Thank you very much. So the next point here is the municipal report. Unfortunately, they are not here with us this morning, so we would move directly to the update, progress update and name recommendation for the Parkway Renaming Initiative. So I would like to invite Madame Passier and her team for the presentation. Thank you, Madam Chair. I am Véronique Despassier. I am the Vice President for the Legal Affairs in the organization. And this morning, I'm pleased to be here. I'm delighted to be here with Hilary. She's an analyst for public consultation, and Amy Girard, Director for Public Affairs. Before we start the presentation, I would like to thank all the members of the multidisciplinary team at NCC who conducted this exercise throughout the last year, as well as all the members for their contributions. In January, the Board of Directors agreed to proceed with the exercise of naming, of renaming, and here we're looking for consensus. Emily, you have the floor. Thank you very much, Véronique, for the opening remarks. So it's a pleasure for me to present the results of the renaming, the designation activities and the engagement activities to rename the initiative. So I'd like to acknowledge emphasize the knowledge of the Algonquin population and to say that we are here on the Algonquin territory since time immemorial. So today, we are gathered here to provide an update on the progress and the outcomes of the naming and engagement exercise, to seek approval on the recommended name for the Parkway and next steps of the process, including the summary report and the future interpretation plan. As you know, in September 2023, the Advisory Committee on Toponymy gathered to determine the approach to use for the renaming process of the Sir John MacDonald Pathway. And during this meeting, the committee agreed that we present the initiative focused on reconciliation. So in January 2023, the NCC Board of Directors agreed to move forward with an Algonquin naming exercise. As a result, in spring 2003, we proceeded with engagement activities with Algonquin communities and the public as well. Now, I would like to present the feedback that we received from the advisory committee, as well as a snapshot of the designation process and engagement activities with the public. During our meeting with the committee, members of NCC shared the following comments. So to use full words, appropriate accents, and accurate pronunciation when communicating the proposed Parkway name. To explore a variety of communication tools to ensure the public understands the meaning behind the proposed name. For instance, using QR, so we shouldn't use QR codes, interpretation plaques, or information on our website, to host the signage unveiling on the east end of the Parkway to showcase the beauty of the river and the site. And lastly, to invite elders and youths to participate and speak at the unveiling ceremony. So the naming exercise and Algonquin engagement was officially launched on February 13th during a meeting with the chiefs and representatives from cultural centers from the Kizzinginsby communities. And afterwards, we held two workshops with community members. Here we see, you see on the screen a picture of the last meeting. So the first workshop was based on an initial discussion talking about name suggestions. And there were also some stories about the river and the neighboring areas. And the second workshop was aimed at providing a recommendation and also sharing other stories. And during these workshops, we see that it really encouraged participation and relationships between different communities. It talked about culture, heritage, and Anishinaabe stories. Participants really appreciated the naming exercise, and they shared the importance and the unique quality of the naming exercise. And lastly, participants identified overarching goals, that is the preservation of the language, the importance of family, the connections from one side of the river to the next. And they also highlighted Algonquin heritage. And they mentioned the honoring of ancestors and the mention of survivors of residential schools. And now I would like to take some time to talk about the public engagement activities. The public contributed to the engagement process by sharing their stories and their memories about the river and the parkway, and also learning about the naming process in its entirety. And the online activities took place from May 2nd to May 21st, and also gave the opportunity to the public to participate in a survey, and also to participate in an online discussion, and also provide interactive comments. And we also held an in-person event on May 10th in an open house session in order to facilitate a discussion and dialogue. And based on the results of these activities, more than 350 people mentioned their connections to the area, be it using the territory or the use of the land for physical activities, for just observations or meetings with their friends. They also talked about their appreciation for the river and its beauty. As a result, the recommended name, the name that was recommended by members of the Kichizibi Mikan, that's the name that was proposed, which means River Road, Great River Road. And this name is important for both communities because it is the name that their ancestors gave the first time to the river, that is Kichizibi. And that has connected Algonquin to their stories, their language, and their culture. The fact that we return to the name that was initially given to the river, it's a way for us to honor the ancestors and their lived experiences, and to raise and educate the non-indigenous people about the role and importance of the river. And then it was proposed that the complete name in Anishinaabe Moren has to be the first language appearing on the signage. And the spelling of the name was confirmed by the participants, since there are several ways to spell these words. The advisory committee on toponymy also confirmed their appreciation of the meaning of the name and the naming process. Lastly, this name, it's in a way for us to go back to the original source, and it's a name that reflects the ancestral connection of the Algonquin Nation to the river. We would organize a signage unveiling ceremony parallelly that will be held on September 30th on the to make sure it aligns with the National Day for Truth and Reconciliation on September 30th. And also we would have people from Kiriganzibi and Pikwakanakan. And public will also be invited. So the next steps of this initiative are highlighted on the screen. In the summer, we would write a summary report. We would produce the signage and also proceed with installation. And we will continue to develop a work plan for the toponymy and ensure that we continue that in September. So it's with a lot of pleasure I am delighted to mention the name recommended, Kichizibi Mikan. Thank you. Thank you very much for this presentation. So, Elena.
Move to approve.
Très bien.
Norm.
Merci, Madame la Présidente.
Thank you, Madame Chair. J'aimerais remercier la CCN pour le travail sur ça. Et selon les principes des Unopican Goodwill, je crois que les choses ont été faites de la bonne manière en consultation et avec les discussions. J'aimerais connaître mes membres des comités, du comité en arrière. Merci beaucoup et j'aimerais appuyer la motion. Any other comment? Please use the mic. Technology, every single time. Thank you very much. So I would like to highlight the processes that were followed, especially when we look at the results, because that's how we were able to ensure a diversified engagement and to ensure participation from all the partners, especially all those involved in this huge project. So once again, congratulations. And the renaming, the name change is part of the reconciliation process, the truth and reconciliation process. So we are going back to the original name of this river. So thank you very much. And the motion has already been seconded.
As someone who has lived in this city for a very long time, I have to say the approach that was used for this project really indicates the transparency that we see from the NCC, and having lived here for such a long time, that's really a change in the reputation that the NCC has. It used to be impermeable. You would just see the results that would come out with no idea of where they came from. The consultation with the communities, their participation, and the transparency. Felicitations. Congratulations.
Congratulations. Denis? Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to join my voice to my colleagues to congratulate you for this renaming process. And what really speaks to me is the return to the original name, to the actual source. We have really ensured that we have really made sure we maintain the name, because there's a name really connected to the physical aspect of this famous river that really marked our Canadian history. So it's with pride that I really second this motion, and that I second this recommendation. So this really ensures the long-lasting nature of the name. So thank you very much. So it's my time to really thank the members of the community who have allowed us to reach this point. So the recommendation was moved by Elena and was seconded by Rob, and I suppose there's no objection in the room. So September 30th would be a very important day when we would reveal in a more concrete way the new name of the drive. So congratulations once more. So everything is moving along very well. So now we are at the point about the Sussex Heritage Courtyard Schematic Design, Federal Land Use and Design Approval. And here we would like to invite Mr. Migueles and his team for the presentation. Thank you very much, Madam Chair. So now we would present to receive your approval, the Federal Land Use and Design Approval project. So we are talking about urban space that are really precious spaces for the capital that was created by the NCC between the years 1960 and 1980, when the commission agreed to renovate, to restore new buildings.
federal land use and design approval, the FLUDA, for the Sussex Heritage Courtyard schematic design was granted in principle by the board in January of this year. This draft approval allowed the design and construction branch to proceed with the detailed design for Clarendon and York Courts and Clarendon Lane based on specific design direction provided in the January approval submission in order to meet construction timelines. The draft board approval in January also directed the NCC's capital planning branch, specifically the long-range planning division and the heritage program, to augment the schematic design document with additional heritage research and analysis and urban planning context in order to provide guidance and set a clear framework for the future projects within the courtyards. So capital planning, in collaboration with design and construction, has revised the proposed schematic plan and developed more detailed demonstration plans to inform the completion of future design work across all of the five heritage courtyards. These subsequent developed designs for all the other individual courtyard construction projects will be based on this final version that you'll see today and will be approved as level two projects. Alors, je passe la parole et je vous présente Amanda Conforti.
So now I would like to present Amanda, the main architect, for the presentation. Thank you very much.
Good morning, Chair and members of the board. I'm pleased to be before you today to present the final schematic design and design guidelines for the Sussex Heritage Courtyards for approval. Returning board members will remember the courtyards from our site visit last October. But just to provide a bit of context, the Sussex Courtyards are made up of the spaces directly behind the NCC-owned buildings along Sussex Drive, forming the five distinct courtyards shown here. These courtyards provide a unique and enjoyable urban experience in Canada's capital. As Alain mentioned in his opening remarks, the draft approval for the Sussex Courtyard schematic design was granted in principle by the board in January of this year. The draft approval included a condition directing the capital planning branch to augment the schematic design document previously submitted by design and construction. The additional work completed since January will be the focus of today's presentation and includes an in-depth heritage analysis, including identification of character-defining elements in each courtyard and across all courtyards, vision statements for each courtyard, providing further guidance for future works, determination of land use gaps and locating opportunities to address these gaps, and finally, revised design guidelines, schematic plan, and demonstration plans. Beginning with the heritage analysis, the heritage team identified the following character-defining elements across all five courtyards. The intimate scale of the courtyard spaces, defined by 2 to 5-story building heights. The interconnected pedestrian system, linking the properties along Sussex Drive. The mix of commercial, residential, and public spaces. The globe lights, also found along Sussex Drive and throughout the Byward Market. The public artworks, both permanent and temporary, the scale, massing, and materiality of the surrounding historic buildings and more recent infill, and the diverse plant material and tree canopies that provide greenery and a park-like setting. The heritage team identified character-defining elements for each individual courtyard as well. Some of the character-defining elements identified for Clarendon Court and Lane include the arched stone porte-cochère into York Court, the scalloped cobblestone paving in Clarendon Court, and the view from the courtyard overlooking the top of the Connaught Building. The character-defining elements for York Court include the arched stone porte-cochère into Clarendon Court, the three large double-height arch shop windows, the large central tree providing greenery and a shaded canopy in warmer months. The character-defining elements for the Jeanne-d'Arc Court include the stylistic wrought iron gates marking the entrances, the narrow passageways and gates that create an intimate transition from the street into the courtyard, the central dancing bear statue, and the fleur de lis motif found throughout the courtyard. The character-defining elements for the Tin House Court include the tin house facade, the unobstructed view within the courtyard of this facade and through to the Beaux-Arts Court, and the massing and materiality of the surrounding stone and brick buildings. Finally, the character-defining elements for the Beaux-Arts Court include the framed views from the courtyard to the National Gallery and the Notre-Dame Cathedral, the 3-story massing and exterior brick walls with stone detailing of the surrounding buildings, and the angel sculpture at the north end of the courtyard. The next element that was added to the schematic design document was a clear vision statement for each courtyard to guide future interventions. So the first states that Clarendon Court and Lane will be designed as a lively meeting place. People will spill out from the retail and restaurants into an outdoor space with public seating and areas of greenery. Public animation will be well balanced with residential uses. York Court will be an intimate urban room tucked away from Clarendon Court and Lane. This courtyard will offer space for admiring art and for group gatherings on cozy restaurant patios. Jeanne d'Arc Court will be the quietest and most restful of the courtyards. It will provide space for relaxing with generous vegetation, and adequate sight lines will provide a feeling of safety within the space. The Tin House Court will have a dynamic identity, characterized by water sounds and the unique tin house facade artwork. It will be designed to have an element of playfulness and surprise, and will be an ideal place for interactive programming and performances. The Beaux-Arts Court is where the spirit of Old Lower Town meets the grandeur of the capital, connecting the courtyards to the Notre-Dame Cathedral and the National Gallery of Canada. This courtyard will have a mix of commercial patios and quiet public spaces to rest and enjoy views. The next element that was revised in the document is the schematic plan. The revised schematic plan defines the spatial organization and functions across all five courtyards using the following elements. The path of discovery, represented by the dashed line here, guides the visitor through the courtyards using visual cues and wayfinding. It improves universal accessibility within the courtyards by providing an unimpeded path of travel. The building apron, shown in a pink tone on this plan, represents the outdoor extension of indoor uses. It varies in size and function based on the use of adjacent buildings and the identity of each courtyard. The active and passive nodes, represented by the circle graphic on the plan, are public spaces that offer site amenities such as seating, sculptural artwork or heritage interpretation, or public programming. The entry points and connections are the hatch tone on the plan and represent an opportunity to improve the pedestrian connection between the courtyards. This element is to be coordinated with the City of Ottawa. Other items that have been added to the schematic plan are the active and inactive frontages. Active frontages, shown here with a heavy green line, represent some level of interaction with the public. For example, an entry into a store or restaurant. Inactive frontages, shown here with a heavy gray line, represent more back-of-house functions or residential or private entrances. We have also identified an existing public washroom within the Tin House Court. Finally, the revised demonstration plans are an illustration of how the schematic plan could be applied to each courtyard. They offer visual cues and examples of potential interventions to be further explored and tested during the detailed design phase. The demonstration plan for Clarendon Court and Lane and York Court shows the existing cafe patio through Clarendon Lane to remain, with the possibility of new planting beds. The existing restaurant patios in Clarendon and York Courts will also remain relatively unchanged. The plan shows opportunities for new public art and interpretive installations that highlight the heritage of the courtyards. New plant beds with flexible furniture are also proposed at the bottom portion of Clarendon Lane. The demonstration plan for Jeanne d'Arc Court shows the existing Dancing Bear statue, which is quite popular, remaining in its current location. The plan shows the enhancement of existing planting beds in the courtyard with new integrated seating elements, as well as new flexible seating proposed around the Dancing Bear sculpture, bringing the focus to the center of the courtyard. The Tin House Court was previously very active prior to the removal of its central water fountain feature. The demonstration plan reintroduces a water feature in this courtyard. Here it's seen as flush with grade level, which would permit other uses of this space when it's turned off. The existing commercial restaurant patio at the bottom left will remain. The plan also suggests a shaded area with flexible seating at the center of the courtyard. The demonstration plan for the Beaux-Arts Court proposes informal seating, shade structures, and extensive plant beds to provide comfort to visitors. The opportunity for large public art and lighting installations is more open toward the right of the plan, where the existing angel statue is situated. A second option for the Beaux-Arts Court was also provided, showing the potential infill development at the intersections of Sussex Drive and Murray Street, and Sussex Drive and St. Patrick Street. The possibility of infill buildings at these locations requires further study and is being considered as part of the ongoing update to the core area sector plan. Any future building proposals would require separate review and approvals. In conclusion, the understanding and planning documents before you for approval today will guide the design development for the rehabilitation of each of the courtyards as funding for implementation becomes available. Subsequent design development phases for each courtyard will be subject to separate Level 2 reviews and approvals prior to construction. So I have the recommendations on the screen now. I won't read them, but I will leave them up for reference. And through you, Chair, I would be happy to take questions or comments.
Merci beaucoup de votre présentation.
Thank you very much for your presentation, and thank you very much, Mr. Migueles, who gave us a tour of the courtyards. So thank you very much. It's more concrete and real for those who are not from the region.
First, thank you, the NCC, for giving us the tour there after our last meeting and put things in perspective. And I spent a good time of my life living in Ottawa when I was studying and afterwards with my career, and I still do spend a lot of time in Ottawa, and I had never seen most of those courtyards. So I'm happy to see this. I'm happy to see the designs, and I'm looking forward to seeing how it is afterwards, and hopefully it brings life to them because they are some pretty unique spaces for the city. Migosh.
Mireille, et puis Tania.
Merci, Madame la Présidente. Je trouve...
Mireille, I find it fascinating how we are thinking of revitalizing these unknown hidden gems and these quiet spaces when we have friends and family that come to visit us here in Ottawa. These are quite unique spots, and what I appreciate most from these spots are the efforts to highlight them and to enjoy them, even though we're at the planning stages to modernize these. We're looking at amplifying the benefits of these little courts. Thank you. Thank you for the good work that you've done, and the in the context of improving these spots, of keeping in mind continued access. This allows us to peek into the heritage of our beautiful city. And thank you for highlighting these little spots in the core of our city, close to the Byward Market. And continue on with the good work. Can I support or second this motion?
I likewise to my colleagues, it's an exciting project for sure, and the possibilities are very exciting. I just have a clarifying question around, I think you mentioned the connection points between the courtyards. Are you seeing something like a physical, visible, sort of pathway, like change in the materials that are used in the streets between, so that, you know, people kind of can know that you can continue on and go to another one? Or is it going to be done through wayfinding? Or I was just unclear around the vision for, you know, between the courtyards or how they would be connected.
Yeah, and I think the intention through you, Chair, is to have a combination of both. I think it's something that needs to be discussed in further detail with the City of Ottawa because it's their land. But I think we're hoping, or the design team is hoping, to use materiality as well as wayfinding elements that will create that visual connection across across the streets to make that connection.
Denis.
Merci, Madame la Présidente.
Denis, thank you, Chair. I can tell you that the Urbanism and Planning Committee was consulted on this, and I am happy to note that most of the suggestions were incorporated in this plan, and the suggestions, should they be the same, or should we maintain the individual character of the courts themselves? And I am happy to see that the character has been maintained instead of, you know, obliterating things and uniformizing things. So it will continue to be explored how to link them. But this is an asset. Norm, you're not alone. I've been to Ottawa for many, many years. You went there last night. You saw how these little spots can be warm. And if you can't go to Europe, come to Ottawa and you will get a reflection or an example of that character and charm. So congratulations, my warmest congratulations for your good work. I don't know if it had been moved, so I will certainly support this. I'm anxious, like with other projects, to see the results. Denis, it was proposed by Mireille, and you can second the motion. So, Lou?
Colleagues, making someone that lives outside of the National Capital Region, it's certainly a gem that I look forward to visiting when completed. But in that regard, we're all pointing to the fact that it's an unknown gem. And I'm just maybe a question around, do we have any way to influence how, you know, the courtyard is branded and then promoted within the city? Do we have strong partnerships in that regard, whether it's with Ottawa Tourism, etc., and how we influence that? Because it's such a, I think, an important part of attracting people to the site. And then a second question, I guess, in relation to that is, to what degree does the NCC have the ability to influence and hopefully monetize sort of elements within the courtyard, whether it's via restaurants, pubs, and or potential, you know, sponsorship-like activities?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think to the first point, it's fair to say that in the visual material that's produced by the NCC, the courtyards are frequent star attractions. We can see the mile of history, the streetscapes, but also scenes of the courtyards. And I'm pretty sure that Tourism Ottawa also picks up on these spaces as part of the material, the package of material that they put out there. But it's something, obviously, that, you know, as we renew, we restart conversations, we put highlight and spotlights again on these spaces, there's always an opportunity to remind people that these are really very very special spaces in the capital and really offer a unique experience. With respect to monetization, I can pass again the floor to my colleague Bill Leonard, but much of the land ownership and building ownership is under NCC, and therefore we do have an ability to curate the experiences to ensure that we have leases that contribute to the animation and the programming intent of each of these courtyards. And that's very much, I think, what my colleagues in real estate have been doing.
And outside of the potential animations and opportunities there, I'm not sure if we've ever done this before, but do we have any sponsorship arrangements that we engage in, or is it against our policy? I'm not sure how we go about that, because I think it could potentially be a great opportunity here to engage, with respect to the whole courtyard sort of pathway.
Merci. Yeah, maybe just two points to add to Lou's question. Alain's right. I think following a particular intervention in a courtyard, we do have the opportunity to raise the profile. So we should use that opportunity. I think it's an important point, Lou. And the fact that even longtime residents of the nation's capital, you know, may not have known the courtyards as well is probably a sign that we can do more, given how special they actually are. And to your second point, just to build build on Alain's observation. We usually have lease agreements where we benefit if our tenants benefit. So we often have a combination of base rent and percentage revenue. So it's also in our interest for them to succeed, because every time a glass of wine is had, the NCC gets a very small part of that revenue. So I think there's a lot of, collaboration that can happen between the tenants, between the NCC, Ottawa Tourism. There is a new governance structure that the City of Ottawa is unveiling for the Byward Market in the coming weeks. And I think there's a recognition by the City of Ottawa that investment and rehabilitation of the parts of the Byward Market that are not ours is also important. And we're working towards the bicentenary of the Byward Market in 2027. Mm-hmm. So a lot of us are focused on contributing and supporting efforts to really revitalize what I would argue is really the jewel in the Capitol's crown, or ought to be the jewel in the Capitol's crown if it isn't now.
Alors, il y a Lise, Denis et Eleanor. Lise.
Oui. Bien, mes commentaires, ça rejoint pas mal tous les commentaires.
Well, I echo all the comments of my colleagues. When Denis was talking about Europe and going there, well, you don't need to go to Europe. We have it right here. It's perfect.
It doesn't show in schematics, but the Aqueduct Committee did comment on the use of technology in the spaces, i.e. QR codes, to contribute to the animation. But that doesn't necessarily show in a schematic. Hopefully that's something we can think about. And I'm thinking, if we're involved in discussing the bicentenary of the Byward Market, let's think about public Wi-Fi down there to contribute to, and maybe we can be partners with that. But I think the notion of QR codes to explain and get the history is something that was raised, and I know it's not part of a design presentation, but I'm sure you've picked up on that, and thank you for that.
Eleanor.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Merci.
Say that this is really important work. Many global cities are losing their uniqueness, and this space is very Ottawa. So I'm very proud of the NCC for doing this work. The other piece that I just want to say is so great is the fact that there is a public washroom in there in terms of equity and accessibility in this space. So thank you for that.
Alors, s'il y a pas d'autres...
Seeing no other comments, the recommendation was proposed by Mireille and seconded by Denis. Seeing no objection, then congratulations. So you will need to work even harder to push forward the work on beautifying these beautiful courts and these hidden gems. The next point on the agenda concerns the new Ottawa Hospital campus, Phase 3, Central Utility Plan, and Central 4, Main Hospital. We are at the 100% schematic design level. So again, we will go to Alain. Yes, once again, the NCC continues to work with its partners to facilitate the planning and construction of the new Ottawa Hospital. Which is aiming to be a world-renowned health facility for Eastern Quebec and also Nunavut. New hospital will be located on federal lands, located close to Dow's Lake.
It was in October 2021 when the board granted federal land use approval for phase one for the master site plan. Subsequently, in 2022, Phase 2, which includes the parking garage and roof park, schematic design and various site mobilization works were approved. Today, the purpose of the presentation is to seek Board of Director approval of the 100% schematic design for Phases 3 and 4, which includes the central utility plant and the main hospital building, which, as well as a recommendation to delegate approval for Phase 3 developed design and various early works to Executive Committee as Level 2 approvals. So I'd like to invite Nicole Howard, senior architect with our federal approval teams, to proceed with the presentation and introduce her to you as well. Thank you.
To begin, I would like to provide a brief overview. A brief overview of the hospital site context and the boundaries of this proposal. The site's lease boundaries are shown within the dark dashed line, and the extent of phase three is shown highlighted with the yellow outline to the south of the site. And phase four for the main hospital building is shown with the orange outline in the middle of the site. The site is located 3 kilometers southwest of Parliament Hill and is adjacent to the Rideau Canal and the Central Experimental Farm, both of which are National Historic Sites. The new hospital is positioned towards the western part of the site, above a treed escarpment. This is the largest contiguous area of the site, allowing for a floor plate configuration accommodating the hospital's clinical functions. The site links an intensifying central urban neighborhood to several popular destinations located nearby, including the Arboretum, the Canada Agriculture and Food Museum, the Ornamental Gardens, and the fields of the Central Experimental Farm. This slide provides a brief overview of the project and the jurisdictions affected. Public Services and Procurement Canada is the custodian of the land and has provided the Ottawa Hospital with a 99-year lease on the 20-hectare site. Phase 3 and 4 affects an area of 15 hectares. In addition to the parking garage that provides approximately 2,500 parking stalls, surface parking is provided for staff and limited public parking at the main entry drop-off, with a total of 622 parking stalls proposed. 168 secured bicycle parking spaces and additional exterior bicycle parking is provided at the entries. The utility plant is next in the phasing to be built in order to provide the infrastructure to support the construction of the main hospital, which is expected to open in 2028. NCC staff have worked closely with the City of Ottawa to align approval review processes and timelines. We also have ongoing coordination with Parks Canada and Agriculture Agri-Foods Canada, who are the custodians of the Rideau Canal and the Central Experimental Farm, respectively. This slide provides an overall axonometric view of the entire development. I will highlight the items, many of the components, for your orientation. The parking garage and future research towers are in the foreground. The public and private spaces within the hospital are segregated in the layout, with the visitors and patients accessing the hospital from the main public entrance facing the northeast at the red dot, and the covered public emergency drop-off and short-term parking area to be located below the main entrance plaza accessed at the yellow dot, while ambulances and first responders make use of the southwest entrance at the ambulance bay drop-off, which is at the blue dot. There are 4 surface parking lots proposed, designated for staff, including the roof of the utility plant at the southwest edge. Service access for material management is from the south, near Prince of Wales. Future expansion is shown in the red dashed line for the West Tower and for the future Heart Institute. This is a section through the main entry looking towards the East Tower, which depicts how the facilities are connected. Visitors and patients can access the hospital primarily from the transit and parking facilities through the pedestrian bridge shown at number 1, as well as the main entrance drop-off area shown at number 2. And the covered emergency public side of the emergency department at level 3, each facing the northeast. Each of these areas align with the central light well, shown shaded in the middle at number 4, providing daylight to the core of the podium at the public levels. The emergency services entrance is at 5, facing southwest, and the utility plant is partially bermed at the farm edge and shown here at 6. This is a rendering of the initial phase of the hospital building, indicating a 4-story central podium and patient care towers of 7 stories for the West Tower and 12 stories for the East Tower, oriented around the main central entrance plaza. This is the same view at dusk, clearly showing the glazed public spaces facing the main plaza and the smaller windows above for the patient care rooms. This is a closer view of the main entry and drop-off area, with the short-term public parking on the right within the circular drop-off. Illustrations here show views of the contemplation garden. The location is shown in the top left site plan within the context of the overall site. Access is from the main entrance to a spiral ramp landscape, providing access to a central gathering area and water feature. There are also paths provided through the existing woodland that maintains many of the existing mature trees. The central utility plant is positioned southwest of the hospital, with the roof elevation designed to be at or below the adjacent elevation of Maple Drive, with a shelter belt provided to limit views to the plant from the adjacent Central Experimental Farm and Maple Drive. Vehicular access to the plant will be from Prince of Wales Drive, and the parking on the roof will be for hospital staff and service providers only. This slide illustrates the location of the 7.5-meter shelter belt that is planned to mitigate views from the adjacent lands. This image is of the utility plant. There is a circulation core and stairs and elevators that will bring staff from the roof parking to grade level. The architecture is proposed to have a similar look and feel to the main building. Here are some views of the proposal within the context. View one is from Queen Elizabeth Driveway near Commissioners Park, looking southwest over Dow's Lake, with the east tower extending upward behind Dow's Lake Pavilion. View two is from Prince of Wales Drive. The extensive existing tree cover and the additional plantings along the west side of Prince of Wales Drive will fully shroud the lower floors of the East Tower year-round when viewed by pedestrians, cyclists, and vehicles traveling along the scenic drive. View three is from Maple Drive, just south of Carling Avenue, which includes the equatorial building as part of the Dominion Observatory in the foreground, and the west tower spans the background in line with the scale of the tree line beyond. View four is taken from further south down Maple Drive, looking toward the hospital. The towers will be seen above the trees as shown here at approximately 30-year maturity, and the podium will be concealed. The proposal is aligned with the strategic policies and objectives of the Plan for Canada's Capital and the Capital Urban Lands Plan. Staff have reviewed the schematic design submission, and the proposal responds effectively to the vast majority of the NCC performance criteria and remains consistent with the design intent of the approved master site plan. There remain several elements of the proposal that require further resolution as the design work advances. These include the reduction of surface parking, site connectivity for pedestrians and cyclists, resolution of the materiality, and improved integration into the context. I will describe these briefly in the next few slides. We are seeking a reduction of surface parking to the minimum City of Ottawa requirements, which is 3,097 parking spaces total for the entire development as per the master site plan, and to adhere to the performance criteria for sustainable site development. The criteria is to retain lands designated for future development as permeable green space until such time when development will occur. In terms of site connectivity, while there have been modifications to address NCC feedback to enhance pedestrian connectivity and porosity throughout the majority of the site, connectivity at the farm edge, at the south edge, is still undeveloped. With adequate mitigation measures, it is expected that improved connectivity could safely be provided to avoid impact in the operations in this zone. Integration into the context includes defining the materiality and maintaining the landscape buffer. The materiality of architectural details continues to evolve in order to integrate the various building phases and create a cohesive ensemble within the cultural landscape and heritage context. This, of course, is expected to be guided by the incoming development partner. As previously shown, there is an extensive 7.5-meter landscape setback between the plant and the Central Experimental Farm, introduced to conceal the utilitarian character of the utility plant. Additional improvements are being discussed with the proponent to ensure that this green buffer is not compromised by proposed retaining walls and to maximize the amount of planting. Adjustments in the design have been made in order to respond to the feedback provided by staff and ACPDAR. The feedback from the committee was generally positive, with recommendations to address a few key items that are now included within the design. Sidewalks on both sides of the main access road up to the main entry have been incorporated, including a separated bi-directional cycle lane provided on the south side. There are improved connections through the tree escarpment with rest areas. The materiality of the exterior continues to evolve with an effort to include wood where it can be maintained. A concerted effort has been made to plant as many trees as possible to reduce the heat island effect. However, there are some architectural and structural limitations for the main plaza and the parking on the roof of the central utility plant. And the Ottawa Hospital continues to meet regularly with the Indigenous Knowledge Circle as they continue also to influence the design. In terms of next steps for these phases, staff will continue to meet with the Ottawa Hospital during design development. Pending the outcome of the meeting today, mobilizations later this summer could include early works, such as tree protection and removal, construction access road to the south off of Prince of Wales Drive, existing services that need to be removed and relocated to service the farm properties, and early servicing for the utility plant and the hospital. It is anticipated that phase two, which is the parking garage, and phase four, the main hospital, will be brought to the board in the fall for design development. Based on staff's review of the new civic development schematic design of the central utility plant and main hospital, staff recommend approval for advancement to develop design. This concludes the presentation, and I will provide some time to review these recommendations.
Merci beaucoup pour ce.
Thank you for this very detailed report and update. Are there any questions or comments? Ken.
Madame la Présidente, I think the design's wonderful. I'd be pleased to move it, Madam. Certainly one of the benefits of this location is the nearby light rail. When you consider the numbers of staff who go to the hospital on a daily basis. And that, I assume, is what's led to some of the reductions in parking. And I know the next phase is a parking garage. Any indication as to whether they're talking about reduced overall parking on this site compared to what exists on the existing site?
Oh, I'm sorry, I don't know the numbers on the existing site. I can follow up and get back to
you. No, just if you knew, that's fine. Thank you.
Andy.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Quick question, maybe I didn't see it in Appendix C. Is there any consideration of evidence-based design? And for those who may be not familiar with it, it's really just human transactions, physical environment, and the physiological assessments that are done to see how these two interact and if there's interdependencies. And it's been used in all buildings, but specifically hospitals, all across Canada. And it comes about not just because of COVID, but because of medical stats. The Canadian Medical Association has a staggering statistic where there's 300,000 hospital-acquired infections each year, which result in 15,000 deaths. And so it leads to a number of sort of concepts in design, simple things like single patient rooms and things of that nature. But there's a lot more, obviously, evidence-based design. Is there any consideration of that in this plan at this early stage?
Actually, all the patient rooms are single. That is a response to COVID. But I apologize again, because I'm not the designer. I can't speak to the actual details. But I know that they have been taking into account lots of recent findings from the pandemic.
Thanks.
Alors, Denis.
Denis, so just to echo Andy's question, so this has come to us twice before the planning committee, and with regards to the interaction with patient, well, there's also the planning of the users and visitors we have suggested several things, and the planning committee has made a lot of recommendations, so it will probably be called on for further approvals. I will second the recommendation. Tanya.
Just reflecting on, you know, parking is always a big consideration in a project of this scale, and it has been one of those reoccurring themes that has come up. And I know that we're looking at the utility plant, but, you know, reflecting back on when the other parking garage, you know, came, this is an interesting balance of how we're being creative with these spaces of, you know, the other one had a green roof that was proposed. This one, you know, now, you know, you can facilitate parking on the surface of the, or on the roof of the utility plant. So I think, you know, I would compliment the team on just the creativity that's continuing to be used in terms of recognizing that it is a large both employer and, you know, there are a lot of people that are going to come, and they're going to come by vehicle access, but at the same time trying to, you know, minimize the impacts and that integrate more the visibility of the impact of parking everywhere. So I think, you know, the teams have done a really good job of continuing to, you know, be mindful of the numbers, but certainly the design and the visibility of them. So congratulations on that.
Alors, merci. A-t-il d'autres?
All right, thank you. Any more comments, questions? Yes, Lise. Well, I want to second the motion. It had already been seconded by Denis, but I know everybody wants to chime in. So the recommendation has been moved by Ken, seconded by Denis. Any objections? Seeing none. The recommendation is adopted, and this can move forward. Thank you for your presentation.
Next point on our agenda, we will talk about the center block rehabilitation project. So we would proceed with, so that's the second to the last presentation, Madam Chair, I promise. So we are delighted to present this time for approval the center block landscape schematic design on the Parliament Hill, which is part of the rehabilitation project. So as you probably know, the center block rehabilitation project represents the most complex patrimonial rehabilitation project that has been launched in Canada by our PSPC colleagues.
Design for the overall center block rehabilitation program and below grade Parliament Welcome Center was approved by the board in October of last year. The proposal before you today is limited to the landscape schematic design of Parliament Hill, excluding surface parking. So this time we will not be talking about surface parking. The proponent will evolve the layout and design of the surface parking in compliance with the Plan for Canada's Capital and in consultation with the NCC. So the surface parking component will be integrated into the design development phase, which we'll come back later. So I'll now hand the presentation over to Amanda Comforty, our senior architect with the federal design approvals. Thank you.
Thank you, Alain, and good morning again, Chair and members of the board. I'm pleased to be before you today to present the 100% landscape schematic design for Parliament Hill, which forms part of the overall center block rehabilitation program. The larger center block rehabilitation program involves the full rehabilitation of the historic center block building, the construction of phases 2 and 3 of a new below-grade Parliament Welcome Center, and changes to the landscape and exterior lighting of the parliamentary grounds and buildings. The proposal before you today is limited to the landscape schematic design of Parliament Hill, excluding the surface parking. In today's presentation, I'll be providing you with an overview of the 100% landscape schematic design for Parliament Hill, a summary of the NCC staff review of the submission, a summary of the Federal Heritage Buildings Review Office, or FHBRO, review and PSPC's ongoing Indigenous engagement, and finally, I'll review next steps and the recommendation for approval. Before we get into the proposed rehabilitation, it's important to note the unique heritage significance of the Parliament Hill landscape. In addition to the individual classified federal heritage building designations for Center Block, West Block, East Block, and the Library of Parliament, the Parliament Hill complex and Parliament Hill grounds also hold classified federal designations. The Parliament buildings and the Parliament Hill grounds are also designated National Historic Sites of Canada. The heritage character of the Parliament Hill landscape resides in the relationship between the grounds, the buildings, Wellington Street, and the Ottawa River. The proposed approach to the landscape rehabilitation, which has been titled Canadian Picturesque, is premised on the cultural landscape approach, taking inspiration from landscape architects Vaux and Scott's original plans and Parliament Hill's river-based setting. The Canadian Picturesque reframes the original picturesque design as a contemporary approach that prioritizes people's relationship to each other and people's relationship to nature. The landscape rehabilitation proposes to reestablish lost sequences and spaces and experiences and enhance human connections to the land and river, improve sustainability and humanize the landscape through the introduction of substantial tree and understory plantings, introduce new amenities such as accessible circulation routes, seating and rest areas across the site, and establish new opportunities for storytelling and interpretation. The 100% landscape schematic design submission includes a comprehensive schematic design report, schematic design drawing package for landscape and site plan, and supporting documentation and information provided in appendices. What is not included in this submission are design details for exterior lighting strategy and design details for signage and wayfinding and other landscape design elements requiring further study, which will be addressed in the next phase of design. A proposal for 109 surface parking spots was included in the submission, but will be subject to further revisions and resubmitted separately for board consideration and approval. The major landscape zones included within the project boundary are the Wellington Street edge, shown here in red, the parliamentary forecourt, and the perimeter plateau. The following slides summarizes the proposed work in each of the three major landscape zones. Beginning with the Wellington Street edge, the rehabilitation proposes to regrade the area between Queen's Gate and South Drive to make it universally accessible. New areas of planting and trees are proposed on either side of the Queen's Gate entrance. New plantings, visible here at the bottom of this rendering, will be introduced along the steep sloped area between the Wellington Street wall and South Drive. Additionally, trees and benches will be introduced along the south side of South Drive, shown in this rendering. These trees will be spaced 10 meters apart, and a large gap on either side of the Queen's Gate will ensure that key views to center, east, and west blocks remain uninterrupted. The diagram in the upper left of this slide illustrates how the new trees will impact the views toward Parliament. NCC staff have requested further details in the next design phase to fully evaluate how key views will be framed and protected. Moving now to the parliamentary forecourt, the proposal reduces the road widths of south, east, and west drives surrounding the formal lawn and widens the sidewalks to accommodate seating and tree planting. The path on either side of the Centennial Flame will be widened by 5 meters, creating an expanded plaza. The Vaux Wall and Central Stairway will be reinstated, and the Vaux Terrace will be renewed with new paving in noble materials, with new planting beds on either side. As mentioned on the previous slide, new trees are planned along west and east drives to create comfortable, shaded places to rest and enjoy views across the forecourt. The species and spacing of these trees will be studied in the next design phase. Benches are proposed under the new trees along east and west drives, offering more places to rest for the crowds that visit Parliament Hill. This rendering shows the proposed benches along West Drive, looking across the forecourt toward East Block. Additionally, removable bench seating is proposed on either side of the central pathway leading to the new Parliament Welcome Centre entrance. This rendering shows the central path in the foreground, looking toward West Block in the background. NCC staff have expressed concerns with the proposed benches along the central path. The exact number, spacing, and design of these elements is to be developed in the next phase to ensure the formal lawn remains as uncluttered as possible and achieves simplicity of design. Moving now to the perimeter plateau, the proponent team saw the center block rehabilitation program as an opportunity to reimagine the perimeter plateau's design and function for the 21st century. The design concept for the perimeter plateau is called the ribbon. The undulating form of the ribbon will create a generous perimeter promenade with a series of unfolding experiences. The ribbon itself is a continuous, sculpted natural stone wall that will be inscribed with stories about Canada and its democracy. The ribbon wall varies in height to respond to adjacent landscaping and will also provide seating at various points. Alongside the ribbon feature are areas of native planting in tailored compositions, as well as a series of winding paths that will invite pedestrians to explore the perimeter plateau. Another key modification to the perimeter plateau is the entry pathway starting at the canal gate at the southeast corner of the site. The existing stepped pathway will be removed and replaced with a universally accessible sloped path. The proposed pathway will establish an accessible link to the perimeter promenade. On the screen now is a close-up plan of the area between Center Block and the East Block. The landscape schematic design is currently proposing enclosed bike shelters just north of the East Block building, shown at the bottom right of the slide. This plan also illustrates the proposed east emergency exit from the below-grade Parliament Welcome Centre, which has been modified since the initial schematic design submission in response to NCC comments. The original submission, shown here, located the east exit stair along the exterior of the Vox wall, and that's what is circled in red on the screen. NCC staff raised concerns that this location and configuration did not meet the NCC performance criteria related to simplicity of design and maintaining the parliamentary lawns and central Vox walls uncluttered from utilitarian and service infrastructure. NCC staff have similar concerns with the proposed bike shelters. In response to these concerns, the proponent team developed a new emergency egress solution. This new option moves the emergency egress north of Canal Lane and will be fully enclosed with a direct connection to the perimeter promenade. The red dashed lines on this drawing denote the interior below-grade egress corridor from the Parliament Welcome Centre, and the red arrow denotes the emergency egress door. These renderings show the proposed discrete exit door onto the perimeter promenade. The integration of this exit with the proposed ribbon wall will be further studied in the next design phase. NCC staff have provided the following direction to the proponent team for the design development phase of the landscape rehabilitation. First, further refinement of the planting beds around the parliamentary forecourt is required to fully evaluate the effects of these new elements on the distinct functions of the formal lawn and pleasure grounds. Further details related to the proposed trees south of South Drive, including species, canopy characteristics, and expected heights, are required to fully evaluate the effects on key views toward Center Block. The details and geometry of the proposed expanded Centennial Flame Plaza require further refinement to mitigate the effect of altering the proportions of the central path. The ribbon feature requires further development to ensure that this design element does not dominate the landscape. And finally, the proponent team must ensure that bike parking infrastructure is located discreetly and does not negatively impact the landscape. The FIBRO has also reviewed the 100% landscape schematic design submission. In general, they have outstanding concerns regarding the Canadian picturesque approach and its compatibility with the existing heritage character of the site. Their report made a number of recommendations for the next design phase, including refining the native plantings and proposed new trees surrounding the parliamentary forecourt to maintain its formal character, and refining the formal entry experience and connection between the Queen's Gate and proposed expanded Centennial Flame Plaza. As far as Indigenous engagement, PSBC continues to meet with First Nation, Métis, and Inuit architects on a biweekly basis to provide design updates and receive their design feedback. In terms of next steps, today we are recommending the 100% landscape schematic design for board approval, with the exception of surface parking. The proponent team will continue to develop the surface parking design in compliance with the plan for Canada's capital, and in consultation with the NCC, and will integrate this component in the develop design phase. Design development of the overall centre block rehabilitation program, including the Parliament Welcome Centre and the Parliament Hill landscape, is anticipated to continue through to the summer of 2024, and the Board of Directors' approval of the 100% develop design is expected for the fall of 2024. The recommendation for board approval is on the screen now for reference and was also included in the written submission. And through you, Madam Chair, I'd be happy to take questions or comments.
Merci de votre présentation qui est vraiment.
Thank you for your presentation. It's really inspiring. You have the floor. Thank you.
Help me understand the elevation that you're shown, that you showed in your presentation of the bike storage area. Is that as it's currently, or is that what you're proposing? Is that what's currently proposed, or is that what you're asking them to make?
So there's a plan that shows where they're proposing the enclosed bike storage. So that's the current proposal. In the next phase, we're asking them to reconsider maybe the placement and design of those to be a little bit more discreet.
Yeah, that was my understanding, because it doesn't look discreet there. So I okay, thank you.
Autre commentaire?
Any other comments, questions? Denis? Madam Chair, thank you for your presentation. Most of the former members know that this is an important issue. It's a very serious topic. Since the onset, I see that a lot of work has been done, and I see from today's proposal some changes have been mentioned, and also some things that you mentioned in your presentation. So the work of reconciliation is on the way. Thank you so much for all the work that you've done with regards to reconciliation, and we have here at the NCC, we have tried to implement our principles for planning. So I thank you for your important work, and I want to move a motion here today, propose a motion. Thank you. Any other comments? Does someone second the motion? Yes, Ken. Okay, so any objection? No? So, the proposed plan, the recommendation is proposed by Denis and seconded by Ken. So, you may proceed. For sure, there are other next steps. There are several other phases to complete. So, see you next time for an update. Thank you. And Mr. Migueles, you again. We move forward with the federal land use and design approval for the 2S LGBTQI plus, so national monument final developed design. You have the floor. Thank you, Madam Chair. As you just mentioned,
through my team, the final design for this important national monument. I would also like to take this opportunity to welcome as our guests the director of the Perch Fund, Michelle Douglas, Mia Hunt, as well as our colleagues from the Department of Canadian Heritage. I'd like to introduce Jason Hutchison, chief of federal design approvals, to present today. Thank you.
Thank you, Alain. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to present this important national monument to you today. The purpose of this submission is to obtain federal land use and design approval for the final developed design of the 2S LGBTQI+ National Monument. I'd like to begin first with a brief overview of the project's context and background. The site of the proposed 2S LGBTQI+ National Monument is located within the Capitol core area, near the intersection of the Portage Bridge and Wellington Street, at the edge of the parliamentary and judicial precincts. The core area boundary is shown in yellow on the slide, and the small red dot is the location of the proposed monument. Zooming in now on the site, you can see that the National Monument will be located on a prestigious 6,300 square meter site along Confederation Boulevard, close to many of Canada's legislative, legal, and cultural institutions. You can see the site outlined in the dashed red line in the photo. Following land use approval for the site selection in January of 2020, NCC staff produced site-specific design guidelines that were given to the finalist teams to guide their design proposals through the design competition. This project is a partnership between three parties. The LGBT Purge Fund is the proponent of the monument and provides all funding. Canadian Heritage is responsible for the design competition and the overall management of the project. And the NCC is the approval authority, provides project management services during the design and construction phases of the monument, and as the landowner will ultimately be the custodian of the monument. The monument will be a visible landmark that will recognize the generations of 2S LGBTQI+ people in Canada and tell the story of those that have been persecuted, abused, dismissed, and marginalized because of whom they desired and how they identify. It will generally acknowledge discrimination experienced by 2S LGBTQI+ peoples and communities, and specifically acknowledge the abuse perpetrated by the Canadian state during the LGBT purge. In January of 2020, the NCC board granted land use approval for the monument site at the northeast side of the intersection of Wellington and Portage Bridge. Canadian Heritage launched a juried two-stage national design competition, including design guidelines, in January of 2021. Canadian Heritage informed their minister of the jury's selection of the winning proposal in March of 2022. The project was presented to the ACPDR in August last year and was generally very well received. The final developed design has responded to comments provided by the ACPDR and NCC staff. Comments of note focused on fine details of the landscape, such as grading and pathways, and ensuring that a comprehensive lighting scheme was developed so that the vision shown in the winning concept could be realized in actuality. The project is well aligned with the NCC's plans, including the plan for Canada's capital and the capital core area sector plan. The proposed land use is consistent with the site's land use designation, and the monument and landscape design contribute to the scenic quality of the parliamentary and judicial precinct. The design of the monument also respects policy in the capital illumination plan and the design guidelines found in the program and design guidelines that were developed for this specific monument. The jury-selected winning proposal, called Thunderhead, was submitted by Team Reefert, composed of Liz Reefert and Peter Sampson from Public City Architecture, visual artists Shauna Dempsey and Laurie Millen, and Albert McLeod, an Indigenous and two-spirited people subject matter expert. The team is from Winnipeg. The initial concept draws on the symbolism of the Thunderhead cloud, which embodies the strength, activism, and hope of the 2S LGBTQI+ communities. Following the announcement of the winning concept in March of 2022, the design team embarked on the design development phase. Over the past year, the design has undergone refinement and has been enhanced while responding to feedback from stakeholders, the public, and has integrated comments from the jury, ACPDR, ACUA, and the NCC staff. This is a bird's eye view of the monument site, which has been opened to increase the views and access from the competition proposal. As you enter the site from the west, or the right side of the image, you see the tribute area. It centers on a sugar maple tree and includes integrated stone seating. The central sculpture is a white cylinder containing a thunderhead cloud shape clad in mirrored tiles. It has large openings at the ground level and simplified forms on the interior. Here's a section through the site looking towards the Ottawa River. Note the gently sloping lawn to the left of the thunderhead. This helps to create a natural amphitheater for performances and gatherings on the site. This is a close-up image of the thunderhead showing the large openings and interior mirror ball-like finish. The thunderhead stands 11 meters tall and is 8 meters in diameter. You can see the tribute area here with the central sugar maple tree. A circular stone bench wraps around the area and allows people to sit and face the middle of the circle or face out towards the thunderhead. An interpretive wall is visible beyond the right side of the bench. This rendering of the north side of the thunderhead shows a healing circle and medicinal garden. Again, a tindlestone bench is, and stepped seating surround the space, which also permits ceremonial fires. Responding to comments from the ACPDR, a comprehensive lighting plan was developed. The site is primarily lit with fixtures mounted on pedestrian-scale poles with illuminated bollards used to highlight the feature sugar maple tree. In addition to this, special feature lighting is planned for the entry signage and the interpretive wall. The thunderhead will be lit through a combination of light tiles on the interior and stage lights mounted on 2 7-meter-tall poles. The lighting allows for dynamic adjustability of color and intensity and is programmable. Here you can see a celebratory event, which we might imagine taking place during a future Pride Month. The 2SLGBTQI+ National Monument will be an incredible place to learn about the historical and present-day discrimination faced by the communities, to encourage acceptance, and to inspire hope for the future. With that, I'll take you to next steps, which is that from June to November of 2023, the team will finalize the construction package development, with implementation of the monument to take place from April of 2024 to June of 2025, and with the unveiling of the monument planned for the spring or summer of 2025. And with that said, based on our review of the final developed design submission for the 2SLGBTQI+ National Monument, NCC staff are prepared to recommend approval of the project. I'll give you a few moments to read the recommendation on this slide. Thank you very much.
Merci, Monsieur Hutchison.
Thank you, Mr. Hutchison. So thank you very much. The monument is very beautiful. Are there any comments, questions?
Alors, Eleanor?
Eleanor?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would just move to approve. It's a very exciting project, so thank you.
Yes, so Eleanor and Tanya, are there any objections? Seeing none, the recommendation is approved. Congratulations. We are anxious to go and see this monument. So I believe that if there are no other items on the agenda, we have accomplished our work for the day. We are adjourned. Thank you, Big Witch.
That's going to be like the coolest monument ever.
Yeah, I know. Just
to go stand in it and look at all the lighting when it's on.